shine like sunshine, like springtime, like something's in the water and I'm taking a deep dive. I'm feeling so weightless, like I'm gonna make it, and nothing in the universe can take this. I can see it clearly now, nothing gonna bring me down.
Welcome to the National University of Singapore
Medical School Healthy Longevity Webinar. Thanks for joining us tonight. I'm coming to you live from the Four Seasons in Singapore, where we're having our Dean's International Council meeting on the progress in the medical school in U.S. And there are a lot of exciting things happening here in U.S., including a lot of features on healthy longevity that we can update you on at some point. But tonight we have one of our own, Dr. Karthik Mallilankaraman, and I'm going to try that last name once, and that's as close as I'm going to get. Karthik is one of our experts in the Healthy Longevity Program on mitochondrial function and aging. I know many of you ask questions on mitochondria and aging all the time, so you'll hear about mitochondria tonight. So I want to remind you to use the Q&A function to send questions. And as you may have just heard, we have Dr. Ko Sok Hong, a research fellow at the NUS Neuroepigenetics Lab, and they will be telling us about their work on epigenetics and schizophrenia.
Hello, everyone. As mentioned, I'm Sok Hong Ko. Today, I'm going to talk about epigenetics and schizophrenia. Epigenetic changes is the study of changes of organism, not due to changes in genetic codes, but due to changes in turning on and off of genes. Let's watch a movie about epigenetics.
Our genome is not just a string of DNA code. It requires tagging to bring it to life so that cells know which part of the genetic code to use and when. This is where epigenetics enters the picture. Epigenetics is a mechanism for controlling when our genes are switched on and switched off. Every cell in our body has an identical genome, but this information is interpreted in different ways to make over 200 different types of cells. These differences in cell types are due to differences in epigenetic marks that caused the genetic code to be interpreted in subtly different ways. Society, the environment, diet, and the choices we make can influence these epigenetic tags and change how genes are expressed.
As said in the movie, turning on and off of genes are by chemical tags on DNA or histone proteins. Today, I'm going to talk about chemical tags on DNA called DNA methylation. This is a DNA sequence of a gene. DNA methylations is the additions of methyl group to the cytosines or CpG couplets. It's used to estimate biological age, which is the rate at you age physically. In this news, this gentleman lives a healthy life plus positive thinking. This environmental factor causes his DNA methylation to look like 45 years old rather than actual age of 69. DNA methylation is also for assessing disease status, which our lab has worked on. We aim to develop a marker to evaluate the stages of severity of schizophrenia. Schizophrenia is a mental disorder characterized by three major symptoms. The first symptom is like hallucination. Second symptom includes social withdrawal. Third symptoms like impairment in executive function memory. These symptoms are evaluated by clinical interview and each is assigned a score. The lower the PANSS score, the less severe the symptoms. There are three stages of schizophrenia development. First is the ultra-high-risk group, which is the prodromal stage. Most of the subject has family history of psychosis and exhibit some severe and frequent sub-threshold or transient hallucinations. About 10 to 15% convert to the second stage, which is the first episode stage. Patients in this stage are characterized by first full-blown psychotic episode. The next stage is the chronic schizophrenia stage. These are patients who have been diagnosed with schizophrenia and treated for a while. The causes of schizophrenia are still unknown, but there are involvement of environmental factor and genetics factor. When there are environmental factor influences, this means epigenetics are involved. They will report epigenetic changes, DNA methylation, especially in relin gene in patients with psychosis. Our lab work on relin genes. Relin genes play an essential role in cell signaling and brain cells migration, brain cells connections in fetus brain development and in adult brain function. This diagram showed relin genes with its promoter before exon 1. We look at the 5 CpG site, CpG 1 to 5 before exon 1. We compare the DNA methylation level of these 5 CpG sites in healthy control, HC, and to the different stages of schizophrenia. The results from our experiments are the 5 CpG site had different DNA methylation profile. The two most notable DNA methylation profile were at CpG 3 and 5. We found that the UHR group has the lowest DNA methylation. UHR DNA methylation was significantly different from that of healthy control. Fe and CS group DNA methylation were higher than UHR. CH, which has treatment for quite a while, were about the same level as healthy control. Notice the reverse from healthy control and UHR. And CS DNA methylation level significantly different from that of UHR. Next, we ask whether the patient's symptoms and the DNA methylation data had any correlations. We found significant correlation between DNA methylation and social withdrawal syndrome. The relationship is inversely related. That means that from UHR straight to FE stage, as the DNA methylation increased, it was accompanied by a lessening of social withdrawal symptoms after 4 weeks of treatment. This correlation is interesting, which means the DNA methylation data can explain symptoms or behavior. The conclusion for our research are, for CpG 3 and 5, DNA methylation were different in the three stages of schizophrenia. Treatment reversed DNA methylation. Inverse relationship between DNA methylation and social withdrawal syndromes were observed from UHR to FE. Our future goal will be to have a larger group to assess association of schizophrenia and aging. This experiment was a collaboration of our UNUS Neuroepigenetic Labs and IMH research groups of Dr. Jimmy Lee and Dr. Attilio Raspisada. Thank you, everyone, for your attention today.
Thank you. I think it's a really interesting question about the link between schizophrenia and aging. There's already some data suggesting that schizophrenia may be accelerating the aging process in affected individuals. And that's one thing to keep in mind. We always talk about aging as a risk factor for disease, but there are a range of diseases that may also be accelerating aging as well. That's kind of a circular or a loop that could lead to more and more aging. So I think that it's important to assess whether schizophrenia and other neurologic diseases have an effect on the aging process in general. And that's something we'll be doing here in the Healthy Longevity Program. Dr. Karthik is an assistant professor in the Department of Physiology and the Healthy Longevity Translational Research Program. So he's one of our very own. His research is focused on understanding the nuances of mitochondrial function, not just in terms of energetics, but in terms of calcium transport and mitophagy. All of these topics are highly related to aging. And so I wanted to bring him on to talk a little bit more about mitochondria in general and about his project. His topic is mitochondrial calcium-driven bioenergetics, the road, the roadblocks, and the journey. And Karthik, I just want to tell you that I'm missing a very good dinner here at the Four Seasons for this talk. So it better be good, okay?
Sure, Brian. Thanks. Thanks for the introduction. I'll make it quick so that you can go for the dinner. Today, I'm going to talk about this mitochondrial calcium-driven bioenergetics, the roads, the roadblocks, and the journey. Okay, I'm an assistant professor in the Department of Physiology and a member of Center for Healthy Longevity at National University of Singapore. And I've been working on this topic for almost like more than 12, 13 years. And so I want to first disclose that I have nothing to disclose. Okay, so it's part of the university policy. And when you walk into a supermarket, you always find all the foods fortified with calcium, rich in calcium and like extra calcium, all this. You take a juice, a bread or milk, or even like a lot of medicines comes with the calcium on top of it. Like people put calcium in the garden to enrich their growth of the plants, I guess. So what does this calcium exactly do? Why do we need calcium? So in 1880s, the discovery of calcium for the requirement of cellular function was an accident. It was a harness technician whose mistake he admitted by using water instead of like a tap water, instead of distilled water for making a buffer, led to an accidental discovery of the requirement of calcium or the use of calcium in cellular functions. Okay, so normally cells require calcium for so many functions, and whatever calcium you take into the body, right? So some of the organelles like mitochondria also take up this calcium, and the mitochondrial calcium uptake, it was discovered in 1961, even though in 1957, Britain Chance mentioned about the role of calcium in regulating the bioenergetics inside the matrix of the mitochondria. So that means like matrix, he knew that matrix has calcium, the mitochondrial matrix has calcium. However, in 1961, two groups independently identified calcium entering into mitochondria. And later in 1980s, it was known that calcium regulates the bioenergetic function. So today I'm going to talk about like how this calcium enters into the mitochondria, what it does. Okay, so calcium can enter into mitochondria through the plasma membrane, calcium transporters, and then like the major calcium store in the cell is endoplasmic reticulum or other like sarcoplasmic reticulum in excitable cells. And whenever you have a stimulus like IP3 or iodine, the IP3 receptor or iodine receptor releases a huge amount of calcium. So if you see a mitochondria inside the cell, it is always placed close to the endoplasmic reticulum or the sarcoplasmic reticulum. So there is a purpose for this. It is closely tethered to the endoplasmic reticulum. So when you have a small amount of calcium puff coming out of the endoplasmic reticulum, what happens? Mitochondria feels a huge increase in calcium outside, and thereby it takes up the calcium. And what does this calcium inside the mitochondria do? So it has two things. Like it can activate cellular life, it can increase the motility of the mitochondria, it can buffer the cytosolic calcium, like buffering like a sudden increase in cytosolic calcium, and it can activate the metabolic enzymes, thereby regulates ATP production. However, when you exceed the calcium in the mitochondrial matrix, it opens up a mega channel called mitochondrial permeability transition pore, where it releases all the mitochondrial content, leading to cell death. So calcium has to be, maintained at a very low level under physiological conditions, and we discovered the mechanisms by which mitochondria maintains it. So today I'm going to talk about how this mitochondrial calcium uptake happens and how this bioenergetic machinery is driven by the calcium. Okay, so when we talk about energy, right, so we get energy from the food we eat, from drink, and more importantly, whatever oxygen you breathe, 99.99% of the oxygen goes into the mitochondria. So the mitochondria is the terminal place where all the oxygen you breathe goes to help in energy production. Okay, so this energy, what this energy is, like so when you go to a country, right, each country has its own currency. Your body requires a currency called adenosine triphosphate, or otherwise called as ATP. So the ATP is synthesized in the mitochondria. Majority of the ATP is synthesized in the mitochondria by a very complex biochemical process, by electron transport and then proton pumping across the inner mitochondrial membrane, thereby driving this tiny pump. Okay, this is the smallest pump you have ever seen. Like, this pump is in the inner mitochondrial membrane. This is nothing but your ATP synthase. This ATP synthase spins, and when it spins, it phosphorylates ADP to ATP. So what you see here, the ADP entering into this motor, and then like the phosphate is added to convert it to ATP. When this motor stops, life ends. Okay, so ATP synthesis is a complex process. Whatever food we eat, it goes into the mitochondria in the form of pyruvate and enters into the Krebs cycle and so on. And thereby, it regulates, it produces energy that is required for the cell. Okay. So what does calcium do? The physiological role of calcium, like in the past 50 years, people have identified calcium is required for so many enzymes inside the mitochondria, like pyruvate dehydrogenase, alpha-ketoglutarate dehydrogenase, isocitrate dehydrogenase, and even ATP synthase requires calcium for its activity. So in the absence of calcium, these enzymes become dysfunctional. The entire ATP synthesis machinery becomes dysfunctional. So calcium is an important second messenger that helps in ATP synthesis by activating these enzymes. Okay, so as I mentioned earlier, the endoplasmic reticulum is closely positioned to mitochondria. And in the past, since the discovery of mitochondria taking up the calcium, the pathways through which mitochondria takes up calcium have been highly debated, and it was initially called as a transporter, and then later on they say it's an exchanger. There are so many routes that mitochondria can take up calcium through. The major pathway, the highway of mitochondrial calcium entry, is a one-way pathway that is called as mitochondrial calcium uniporter, which in short, a lot of people put as MCU. So this MCU is a complex of multiple proteins, and it is sitting in the inner mitochondrial membrane, and it is tightly regulated. It's not just open up when the calcium is present. It reads the calcium outside the mitochondria, it reads the calcium in the matrix, after which it opens up. So today I'm going to talk about how we discovered these components of the mitochondrial calcium uniporter. So that is to study the mitochondrial calcium, right? We use a live cell confocal imaging where we add dyes that sense cytosolic calcium as well as mitochondrial calcium. What you've seen on the left side here is a normal cell that takes up calcium in the mitochondria. And when the cytosolic calcium, which is green, when it increases, the red color increases. So cytosolic calcium increase activates the mitochondrial calcium uptake. Immediately, mitochondria takes up calcium. The sensors, the dyes inside this organelles and the mitochondria gives out the fluorescence. That's how we started our screening using this this methodology, and screened 46 different genes that we thought could be part of mitochondrial calcium uniporter, and identified MCUR1, which is coil domain containing 90A, a protein which is unclassified, which is present in the inner mitochondrial membrane. And so as a snapshot of what is happening in the live cell imaging, you can see this green fluorescence that goes up is the cytosolic calcium increase after agonist stimulation. And then right after this, the mitochondria immediately senses the calcium. It overlaps almost closely, and the mitochondria takes up this calcium. In the absence of MCUR1 on the right side, you can see there is no red signals. Only few cells have this red signals that indicate that MCUR1 is required for mitochondrial calcium uptake. In the absence of MCUR1, mitochondria cannot take up calcium. So we further characterized this protein and showed that this is localized in the inner mitochondrial membrane. And we want to make sure that it is a direct effect of the loss of MCUR1 that results in the defective mitochondrial calcium uptake. So we checked whether it alters mitochondrial membrane potential, because calcium uptake into mitochondria is an energetic process. It requires mitochondrial membrane potential. So what is mitochondrial membrane potential? So every membrane, every biological membrane has a current. For example, plasma membrane has minus 40 millivolts, whereas mitochondrial membranes, inner membrane has minus 160 to minus 180 millivolts potential. So when you drop drop this, when the mitochondria drops this potential, it becomes dysfunctional. The ion channels in these membranes cannot function properly. So while loss of MCOR1 does not alter mitochondrial membrane potential, or it does not even alter the content of the mitochondria present in these cells, thereby, so MCOR1 is definitely a component of the mitochondrial calcium inhibitor. And we further characterized using a permeabilized system approach where you use multi-excitation, multi-emission spectrofluorimetry. I'm going to just briefly explain this slide. So if you can see, there is a purple color, which is the FURA2FF fluorescence. So we use two different dyes, FURA2FF, which is a calcium indicator, and we use JC1, which is a mitochondrial membrane potential indicator. And these two dyes are added in the bath, and we permeabilize the cells with a titrated concentration of digitonin. And we add topsegargin to make sure that the Circa pump, which is a pump in the endoplasmic reticulum that can take up calcium, does not take out all the calcium that we add. So we permeabilize the cells. As we see, the mitochondrial membrane potential, the dye goes to the mitochondria. The mitochondrial membrane potential is measured here, and the bath calcium is measured here. And when we add a bolus of calcium into the bath, right, what happens, like, mitochondria senses this calcium and takes the calcium up into the mitochondria. So the FURA2FF, what we use is a membrane impermeable dye, so it cannot cross into the mitochondrial membrane, so it stays outside. That's why you see a fluorescent decay. So this fluorescent decay indicates mitochondrial calcium uptake. So to further confirm what we are measuring, this mitochondrial calcium uptake and the mitochondrial membrane potential, we uncouple the mitochondrial membrane potential using an uncoupler CCCP, and you see a mitochondrial membrane potential drop, and then, like, all the calcium is released into the bath. Okay, so this, using this experiment, we further tested MCOR1 knockdown, whether it affects the mitochondrial calcium uptake. Yes, it does. Cells lacking MCOR1 does not take up calcium. So we can rescue this phenotype with the shRNA insensitive MCOR1 reconstituted in the knockdown cells, and we were able to see the mitochondrial calcium uptake back in action. So we discovered a positive regulator of mitochondrial calcium uniporter, which aids in the calcium uptake into the cell. So as I mentioned earlier, calcium is required for the bioenergetic function of the cell. So we checked whether the mitochondrial bioenergetics is altered in MCOR1 knockdown cells, and we show that, like, mitochondria lacking MCOR1 cannot produce enough ATP. So as a result of it, the AMP-ATP ratio is altered. So when the AMP-ATP ratio is altered, what happens? It activates a metabolic sensor called AMPK, and it leads to pro-survival autophagy. So loss of MCOR1 not only alters the mitochondrial calcium uptake as a downstream mechanism, what happens is it activates a pro-survival autophagy mechanism, which mimics starvation condition. Okay, so in order to use this as an opportunity to study whether it can alter in any whether we see this kind of, like, alterations of mitochondrial calcium uniporter in any diseases, we used endothelial dysfunction model. We exposed this endothelial cells to oxygen glucose deprivation condition, and we see a sharp decrease in MCOR1 in these cells. So we were so excited that, okay, so when you decrease MCOR1, right, you are activating autophagy. So this could be a protective mechanism which could protect the endothelial cells, whereas this is insufficient. The normal downregulation of MCOR1 in the endothelial cells in response to oxygen glucose deprivation is insufficient to protect the endothelial cells. So we should work on this pathway to activate this, like, further to compound with other activators of autophagy in endothelial dysfunction. And so we published this a few years ago, and we were continuing to work on, like, another pathway, mitophagy. So since autophagy is, like, a type of autophagy where dysfunctional mitochondria are eliminated from the cells, right? So we wanted to check whether MCOR1 has any role in mitophagy. So we use this YFP-Parkin expressing HeLa cells, and we depolarize the mitochondrial membrane potential using the uncoupler, and we damage the mitochondria. And you can see the parkin goes right into the mitochondria. Okay, so immediately after the depolarization, parkin goes to the mitochondria. It is an indicator that mitophagy is initiated. So when we overexpress MCOR1, what happens? The cells that overexpress MCOR1 does not have this parkin puncta, which indicates it is delaying this mitophagy process. So MCOR1 somehow delays this mitophagy process. We checked with other agonists like oligomycin and antimycin A, which also depolarizes the mitochondrial membrane potential. And we see a similar pattern in these cells. So the manuscript is in preparation, and I don't want to talk in more on this one. We have identified the mechanism by which MCOR1 is regulating this mitophagy, and you'll soon see the manuscript. So while screening for this MCOR1, we also had MICU1 in our screening list. And at that time, MICU1 was identified as a positive regulator of mitochondrial calcium uptake, whereas we did not see this phenomenon. Whereas what we saw was when you lose MICU1, right, under physiological conditions, mitochondria was overloaded with calcium. So mitochondria has to have a very low levels of calcium in order to do its physiological function, whereas this mitochondrial calcium overload runs this electron transport chain faster and results in oxidative stress. So loss of MICU1 results in elevated basal mitochondrial calcium in normal cells. So we found out that MICU1 acts as a gatekeeper of the mitochondrial calcium unipolar. So under resting physiological conditions, so this is in the permeabilized cell system, you see, normally the cells can, when you permeabilize the cells can release around 950 nanomolar of calcium, whereas the MICU1 knockdown cells are calcium thirsty. They keep taking up the calcium. They cannot guard the unipolar. The unipolar is wide open. All the calcium gets in, and thereby it overloads the mitochondria with the calcium. So MICU1 acts as a gatekeeper of MCU. So there are two different mechanisms by which mitochondria maintains this calcium levels inside the mitochondrial matrix. So one is by constant calcium uptake. Another one is by the gatekeeping function of MICU1, which decides when to let the calcium into through the uniporter. So MCOR1 is a positive regulator, MICU1 is a gatekeeper. It's not a negative regulator. I would say it's a gatekeeper, because if it is a negative regulator, when you overexpress, there should be a reduction in mitochondrial calcium uptake, where we do not see that effect. MICU1 acts as a gatekeeper of mitochondrial calcium uptake. So with this one, we also started to think about all these dye-based mechanistic studies for calcium measurements, right? It's not feasible in tissues. So a lot of people started working on this mitoplasm patch clamp electrophysiology, but only a very few labs have been successful so far. Around 8 or 9 labs have been successful around the world to patch mitoplasm. So what is mitoplasm patch clamp electrophysiology? So to study ion channels, electrophysiology is the most accurate method. In this methodology, if you see here, what we have here is a mitoplast. Mitoplast is nothing but mitochondria devoid of outer mitochondrial membrane. So you have the inner mitochondrial membrane with all its contents inside, and we use a patch pipette to patch this close to 1 micron size, this mitoplast, and then we break open this mitochondrial membrane, and then we pass this current and we clamp the voltage. And it's a very complex process. I'm just trying to simplify it. And we study the calcium flux across the membrane by studying this current densities. So in this one, if you see here, the black trace here, so when we ramp the voltage from minus 160 to plus 80, you can see there's no calcium uptake. When there is no calcium outside, there is no flux here. So when we put 100 micromolar calcium in the bath, right, there is a current that passes through the mitochondrial membrane. When you increase to 300 micromolar, you see a slight increase. When you increase to 1 millimolar, there's a more increase. And when you block with a mitochondrial calcium unipolar blocker, the current, even in the presence of 1 millimolar calcium, there is no current across the inner mitochondrial membrane. So using this methodology, we further confirm that MCOR1 knockdown does not take up calcium. And when you overexpress MCOR1, you have more calcium coming in. So as a positive regulator, when you reduce the expression of this protein, right, it reduces the calcium uptake. When you increase the expression of this protein, it enhances the mitochondrial calcium uptake. So it's a very good protein that we can use to target and tweak the mitochondrial calcium uptake machinery. And we also use this mitoplasmic patch clamp electrophysiology to further confirm the MICU1 as a gatekeeper of mitochondrial calcium uptake. And there's another protein, MICU2, which is a paralog of MICU1, which also has a gatekeeping role in mitochondrial calcium uniporter. Okay, so using multiple techniques by confocal imaging, by permeabilized cell system approaches, and complemented with mitoplasmic patch clamp electrophysiology, we showed that gatekeeping is indeed regulated by MICU1 as well as MICU2. And so the roads towards the mitochondrial matrix, or this mitochondrial calcium uniporter complex proteins, that's what I was talking about, the roadblocks. Okay, so when you talk about mitochondrial calcium uptake, right, so you have to have enough calcium outside in order to open the gate. Okay, so more than 2 micromolar calcium in the cytoplasm will help to open the mitochondrial calcium uniporter. Okay, however, when you have too much of calcium in the matrix, right, that also helps in opening the gate. Okay, so mitochondrial calcium uniporter is regulated in a complex mechanism by both calcium outside as well as inside the mitochondrial matrix. So the question now is, can we use this methodology? So whatever we have learned from this, okay, so we know that mitochondrial calcium uptake is defective. A lot of people have been reporting mitochondrial calcium uptake is defective in aging because of the defects in mitochondrial membrane potential. Okay, however, we wanted to test this. Okay, so here we are clamping the membrane potential by giving a number, the voltage. We set the voltage for the membrane. So whether the membrane potential is defective or not, we set the membrane potential, and we studied using this mitoplasmic patch clamp electrophysiology in young as well as old mice kidney. So this is a 5-month-old mice kidney and an 18-month-old kidney. You can see that the current density is really higher. It's like more than like, 1/3 higher in young mice. So, and it keeps decreasing as we age. So the mechanism by which mitochondrial calcium uptake is reduced is by the expression being altered, the mitochondrial calcium uniporter complex expression being altered, and thereby it regulates the decline in bioenergetics in aging cells. Okay, so we have data with the kidneys. We're expanding our search in other tissues. So interestingly, mitochondrial calcium uptake is different across different tissues. So you cannot expect the same current in kidneys versus you cannot compare kidneys versus muscles. Both have different calcium uptake. So in fact, like a highly energy demanding tissue like heart has a very low levels of calcium uptake, which is really surprising to us, like which was published by Francesca back in 2012. She compared like different tissues. Like this is from Yuri Gritschok's lab. They compared different tissues, and they showed that different tissues have different mitochondrial calcium uptake function. So in order to target mitochondrial calcium machinery in aging, right, so we need to activate this pathways. We need to enhance this mitochondrial calcium uptake. Thereby, you can enhance the bioenergetics. So that is the area we're working on. And I would like to thank Shen Hanming and Brian and Kevin for helping us with most of the studies, and Horia for training me on mitoplasmic patch clamp electrophysiology. And I would like to thank the Ministry of Education and National Medical Research Council for generous funding, as well as funding from Center for Healthy Longevity Translation Research Program. So with this one, I would like to take any questions. So this is the journey I took to reach here.
Thank you, Karthik. I mean, I think that's really interesting. First of all, I want to say that while I was complaining about missing my dinner, Karthik has been the source of many of my dinners. He and his wife are wonderful Indian cooks, and I think they feel sorry for me. We live in the same complex and I don't cook. And so they bring food down all the time to try to, you know, keep me from getting too thin, which is not really a problem. But the food is spectacular. So thanks a lot, Karthik.
Thank you.
So this is really interesting. I think that there's a lot of science here. And one of the things that that people listening that aren't scientists might take from this is that, you know, this is really the detailed efforts that go into really unraveling how cells work are really amazing. The progress that biological science has made over the last 30 years is startling. The idea that you can like patch a mitochondria and look specifically at what a small mitochondria, which is a tiny molecule or tiny structure inside a cell, which is already a tiny structure, is doing is really cool technology. And I think that Karthik's one of the best at that. So I'm always impressed when I see those talks. You know, I'm going to start simple and work toward more complex, if that's okay. So one of the things I think that scientists know, but maybe the general public doesn't know, is that, you know, mitochondria are really kind of thought to be symbionts, right? So they're, so where do mitochondria come from?
Well, so I'm in a very small group of people who do not believe that.
I'm starting a controversy here, Karthik.
It's fine. The reason why I would say that is okay. So
First of all, say what people believe, and then say why you don't believe it.
Okay, people believe that mitochondria originated from a bacterium because it has its own DNA, which is a circular plasmid-like DNA, and which encodes only for like 13 proteins, which are like part of mitochondrial complexes. And the reason why I don't believe that mitochondria originated from bacteria is that mitochondria imports more than 1300 proteins from the nuclear genome in order to become functional. Okay, if you miss one gene, right, then it wouldn't be functional. So that's the reason mitochondria is not a self-sufficient machinery. And at least like if it were like 80% or more self-sufficient, then I would believe that it came from bacteria. But
do you have any thoughts on the origin of mitochondria then? I mean, why would this organelle have DNA in it?
That's a good question. So in order to protect, in case of an emergency crisis condition, right? So you want to have a generator room separator way away from your factory, okay? In case of fire or anything, right? Like, so you do not damage that. So you don't want all the energy producing machinery lying around in the cell. So they wanted to compartmentalize this and keep it safe. Another reason is that like this energy producing mechanism also produces oxidative stress, which is reactive oxygen species that could damage other organelles. So interestingly, mitochondria is like a guy who sacrifices, and I wouldn't say guy because it comes from the mother of the all the living organisms. So this girl, like she takes up all the blame, and all the reactive oxygen species damages the mitochondria. So when the mitochondria is enough, like damaged enough, right? The damaged mitochondria is fissionated out. It is sent for clearance by mitophagy process. So in diseases like Parkinson's disease, the mitophagy is defective, and thereby they accumulate and they produce a lot of reactive oxygen species and damage the cell. So that is one reason why mitochondria is compartmentalized and kept away.
So one question I want to ask you is that there's a famous aging research. Well, not really a scientist. He's a scientist, but he's also kind of a visionary, Aubrey de Grey. And he's come up with a list of things that need to be done to achieve human immortality. One of those things is to, because the mitochondrial DNA is subject to more mutation and harder to keep control of, his view is that we should move all the mitochondrial DNA into the nucleus. Can you give me, what do you think the feasibility, I have my opinion as you might guess, but what do you think the feasibility of this kind of an approach is?
Okay, so I'm always amazed by the mitochondria, by which the architecture of the mitochondria, when you talk about the proteins of mitochondria, right, they have a signature, like a mitochondrial targeting sequence in all their proteins. So to cross the outer mitochondrial membrane, to cross the inner mitochondrial membrane, they have these sequences, different sequences that will allow any protein to enter into the mitochondria. And so that is one drawback, like when you want to put all these proteins into the nuclear genome, right? Then it's not going to work because you have to have all the mitochondrial targeting sequences. Even if you have mitochondrial targeting sequence, right? So these proteins that mitochondria produces, right? They complex with the iron and sulfur. So the ferric sulfur complexes, they fold these proteins. So you have to have iron imported into the mitochondria. There are iron transporters like sideroflexins. They help in the transport of iron into the mitochondria. And there are like sulfur transporters, like they transport all the sulfur, the FES complexes. So there are two different ideologies, like there are clusters formed outside, transported in, and the clusters that are formed inside the mitochondria. In order to fold these complex subunits properly and put it into the complexes, complex one, complex two.
Yeah, that's really interesting point because, you know, in yeast cells, which are a more simple eukaryote, single-celled organism, they're interesting because they don't need mitochondrial energetics. So these are cells that if you give them enough glucose, they can live on glycolysis and generate enough energy to survive. So you can actually remove the electron transport chain function from the mitochondria and they still live. They do quite well as long as they're on glucose. The interesting thing is, though, that if you remove the entire mitochondria, they die. And so scientists were really interested in trying to figure out what was the mitochondria doing if it wasn't making energy. And it turns out that it's making these iron-sulfur complexes, because if you don't have iron-sulfur complexes, there are also a large number of proteins outside the mitochondria that require iron-sulfur binding to function. And so I think people tend to assume that mitochondria are really just to make energy, but they have a number of other roles as well. And that kind of brings me to a question. You know, people that were observant, and you already mentioned this, but people that were observant in the talk had seen this protein called parkin, and they might think that that's linked to Parkinson's disease, which it is. And so I wonder if you can sort of provide a little bit of the role of parkin and how it was linked to Parkinson's disease. And then my question is, does that mean that mitophagy has a major role in Parkinson's disease?
So there are two parts of this question. So first, before we go into like whether mitophagy is part of Parkinson's disease or not, I would like to briefly explain what happens during mitophagy when the mitochondrial membrane potential is depolarized.
Yeah, so start simple because I'm not sure, Karthik, sorry to interrupt, but I'm not sure that people know the relationship between autophagy and mitophagy. So start with a very simple answer and then build toward where you're going.
Okay, so autophagy is a process by which a cell eats itself. Okay, so any dysfunctional cell or like cell going to die like can be eaten up, okay, to rejuvenate the whole tissue, okay? So similarly, inside the cells, the organelles that are damaged needs to be removed in order to rejuvenate the cells, okay? So one such pathway is called as mitophagy because mitochondria is eaten up here. So how does this happen? So there should be a signal that goes out from the mitochondria saying that, okay, I'm dying, eat me up. Okay, so that signal is mitochondrial membrane potential depolarization. So mitochondria have mitochondrial membrane potential, as I mentioned during the talk, minus 180 millivolts. So when the mitochondria depolarizes, what happens is a protein called pink one, which normally goes into the mitochondria, gets chopped off, and then like it's thrown out of the mitochondria for degradation, gets stabilized on the mitochondrial outer membrane. Okay, so pink one is a serine threonine kinase. So in simpler term, any kinase can phosphorylate other proteins. So pink one is an interesting protein. It goes to the mitochondria under normal physiological conditions. It's a visitor. It gets chopped off, thrown out. Okay, when mitochondria is depolarized, this pink one gets stuck on the outer mitochondrial membrane. And when it gets stuck on the outer mitochondrial membrane, it autophosphorylates itself and signals other proteins. And it phosphorylates, ubiquitins, and then it phosphorylates parkin. So parkin is a protein that is in the cytoplasm all the time. Okay. So pink one invites this parkin, okay, phosphorylates it. And pink parkin is nothing but a E3 ubiquitin ligase. It has a ligase activity, and also it has like a, it can phosphorylate other protein, ubiquitinate other proteins in the outer mitochondrial membrane. So when parkin translocates to the outer mitochondrial membrane, it adds ubiquitin chains to all the outer mitochondrial membrane proteins. So this is the real signal to the lysosomes. Lysosomes are machinery like organelles that go and eat up all the damaged organelles. So these lysosomes come and fuse with this ubiquitinated mitochondria, and then they chop up all this mitochondria. They take up inside and then chop up all these. So in Parkinson's disease, right, this mitophagy is defective. There are many reasons why the mitophagy is defective in Parkinson's disease. One is genetic. Okay, if there is a mutation in the pink one or in the Parkin, both pink one and Parkin are required for mitophagy. This is a major pathway, well-studied pathway. That's why I'm talking about pink one, Parkin pathway. There are other pathways too. I don't want to confuse the audience. So pink one is like, if the pink one is mutated, there are several mutations that have been reported. So patients with Parkinson's have a pink one mutation. So the pink one cannot function properly. If the pink one cannot function properly, it cannot bring in Parkin. Okay. So if the pink one is okay, but Parkin is mutated, right? So pink one can bring in the mutated Parkin, but it cannot ubiquitinate other proteins. It cannot open up and ubiquitinate other proteins, thereby the mitophagy process is inhibited. So you accumulate damaged mitochondria. So when you accumulate damaged mitochondria throughout the life of the cell becomes stressed and then they die because of two reasons. One, they cannot produce enough energy. Second reason, because of the reactive oxygen species, this damaged mitochondria constantly produce. So that's how.
Is it known why this is particularly linked to dopaminergic neurons?
I'm not sure, Ryan,
So anyway, I was off track. My question though was, is there any link between calcium levels and Parkinson's disease, especially like sporadic Parkinson's, which might not be linked to direct mutations in pink one and Parkin?
Yeah, loss of function of pink one can alter the mitochondrial calcium uptake. There are studies going on saying that like pink one can regulate the mitochondrial calcium uptake. And then Parkin can also bind to MIQ1 and hijack the MIQ1, thereby like affect the gatekeeping function of the mitochondria. So there are like studies coming up. It's a new field. And in the past 10 years, we and others have identified the components of the mitochondrial calcium unipolar, and still people are adding up different components to be part of this channel. This channel is a huge channel. So
yeah, I'm thinking no more broadly. I mean, have people measured like blood calcium levels and in relation to Parkinson's disease, is calcium levels linked to the disease? It makes you wonder, right? Because in cases where there are not mutations in pink one and Parkin, if calcium levels are altered, it still may alter the activity of those complexes.
We have measured, we have used this methodology to study whether, when you alter the mitochondrial calcium, can you affect the Parkin's, like mitophagy progression? And mitochondrial calcium uptake has nothing to do with this mitophagy progression. So
you don't think it's linked?
It is not linked according to what our data says.
Mm-hmm. So let's come back to, you did, calcium is decreased during aging though.
Yes.
And so you would expect that in that context, the mitochondrial function is decreased?
Yes. So a lot of studies have been reporting, okay, mitochondrial calcium uptake is like bioenergetics is defective. So upstream of bioenergetics is calcium. So calcium uptake is defective. They are thinking that, okay, the mitochondrial membrane potential is lowered because of mitochondrial DNA mutations and oxidative stress and so other things, right? So they started trying antioxidants to reduce the oxidative stress levels to rescue the bioenergetic function, but did not happen. There are two reasons why it did not happen, because the mitochondrial calcium uptake defects, what we see in aging, is not purely because of the defects in mitochondrial membrane potential, because of the defects in the expression levels of the mitochondrial calcium unipolar components. That's why we are seeing this defect. Okay, so we are barking at the wrong tree. So we shouldn't be, you know, focusing more on like oxidative stress. Rather, we have to go upstream of it, like which calcium is the key. So that's where we should work on to modulate this.
So you think calcium. Supplementing calcium could increase mitochondrial function?
But no, it wouldn't, because your mitochondria, the pathway, the road to mitochondrial matrix, right? The pathway through which calcium enters, this pathway has the defect.
So increasing the calcium is not going to have any effect in that context, because the rate limiting step is the entry mechanism.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. So by using compounds or other things that can alter the expression levels, we can.
You want to target the levels of the complex directly.
Yeah. Yes.
All right. Well, maybe so Janjira is here. She's a regular on the show, and she's taking questions from the audience. So she's got some, I'm sure, cool questions to ask you.
Thanks, Brian. So yes, we have a number of questions from the floor. So first question from Yohendran. So he asks, if the mitochondria is so calcium sensitive, do we know what are the targets in the mitochondria?
What's calcium doing when it enters the mitochondria? What enzymes is interacting with?
By the way, dehydrogenase, isocitrate, dehydrogenase, alpha ketoglutarate, dehydrogenase, ATP synthase, even ANT, which is adenosine nucleotide transporters, right? They also are sensitive to calcium. So,
yeah. So you mentioned ATP synthase, but those other enzymes are involved in the Krebs cycle or TCA cycle, and so that's a precursor pathway that establishes molecules to go into the electron transport chain. So it's affecting, you know, energy production both in the TCA cycle and in the electron transport chain. So bad news. Jen?
Okay. Thanks for the response. So we have another question from Vincenzo. So what do you think about using compounds that boost mitochondrial calcium uptake for aging or therapeutic applications, and the fact that different organs have different levels of mitochondrial calcium uptake? Could it be detrimental in certain organs?
Yes, it would be. Because, like, for example, heart requires very low level, like takes up very low levels of calcium, and it has plenty of mitochondria. It takes up very low levels of calcium. It requires a lot of ATP. So how it manages is a big mystery. Okay, if we boost up this mitochondrial calcium, what happens? We end up resulting in mitochondrial calcium overload. So we have to be, very careful while increasing the mitochondrial calcium in the matrix, because the mitochondrial calcium overload will cause oxidative stress and lead to cell death. So you have to balance it, because the uptake pathway is a highway, okay? Whereas the efflux pathway is through exchanges, like sodium calcium exchanges. It is like, you know, a smaller road. There are two-way roads, okay? So it depends on the traffic and all this. Like sometimes it gets very slow. Okay, so you cannot like take up too much calcium, and then you cannot excrete the calcium. So mitochondria has to balance.
Yeah, I'm not an expert, but I think that you have heartbeat irregularities when calcium levels are too high, right? They're actually pathological.
Yeah, that is in cytosolic calcium.
Oh, that's a role of cytosolic calcium.
Okay, thank you for the answer. So we have another question. So do caloric restriction, intermittent fasting, or exercise regimens actually contribute to maintaining mitochondrial calcium levels?
Good question. We haven't tested it, like even though we had the opportunity, like when working with Gary, but at that time we didn't have this myoblast patch clamp electrophysiology established. By now, it's time for us to jump into those areas to see whether it has any role.
I think that could be extended even to other longevity interventions as well. You know, a number of things that extend lifespan are thought to increase mitochondrial biogenesis or improve mitophagy. I think that we don't really know at the level of the analysis you do, at the patch clamp analysis, you know, what these interventions do to affect mitochondria. I think the calcium uptake, I think it would be really interesting to see if there's a commonality between many different longevity interventions and how this calcium functions in the mitochondria.
So, Brian, having said that, you remember we tried AKG, not the calcium AKG, the normal AKG. We saw some reduction in mitochondrial calcium uptake in muscle mitoplasts, but we did not have enough ions for that one. So we have to
go back and see the increased numbers and extend it to other interventions. So what do you think about, you know, I've talked about ways you could think about reversing the decline in mitochondrial function with aging. What do you think the best strategies are for that?
Okay, so the best strategy is to have a compound that can slowly increase, not rush the mitochondrial calcium unipolar to take up the calcium. And there are two ways we could do. We could do tissue specific, like gene therapy. Gene therapy is like to activate or increase the calcium unipolar components, or like tissue specific activators of this of the mitochondrial calcium unipolar components. The other way is to increase the gatekeepers thereby, you reduce the if you see any calcium overload, right? Then you can play around with the gatekeepers. So these are the two strategies you could use to manipulate this.
Yeah. I think we need to think harder about this because it's we know mitochondria has such an important role in aging, and there are a number of interventions that have indirect effects, but targeting it more directly may have interesting outcomes with regard to aging. Jan, there's a couple more questions. You want to go ahead?
Yeah. So there's another question by Shanaka. So is there any connection between calcium, mitochondria, and muscle mass in the aging process?
Yes, it is. Yeah. So mitochondrial calcium uptake regulates the bioenergetics, right? So if you are constantly running this electron transport chain, and you accumulate RAS, and so the muscle damage could be more. So if you reduce the calcium in the muscle, right, so thereby you can enhance the mitochondrial biogenesis, and thereby you can increase the muscle mass.
Thanks for the answer again. So there's another question. So is there a gender difference with regards to the initiation, progression, or severity of mitochondrial decline and proteostasis during aging?
We haven't studied that yet. So all these mice we tested were male mice. So we haven't used any female mice to test this one. So
okay. So there's another question from Stephen. So what would be some of the major challenges or limitations of targeting the decline in mitochondrial function and proteostasis during aging in order to improve health span and lifespan in humans?
Okay, so monitoring these changes in calcium in real time. So that's one area I'm very much interested in, where a lot of the sensors have been developed by many labs. So can you monitor in real time when you do an intervention? Is it increasing the calcium in the mitochondrial matrix, or whether it is, reducing the mitochondrial calcium uptake? So these ratiometric sensors that can be expressed in mice, and doing intervention in those ones and imaging them using multiphoton or other methodologies could help us to tweak the dosage of whatever drugs we use. So that's one thing I'm interested in.
So Karthik, thanks a lot for doing this. And Jan, thank you. I'm sorry, we're out of time and I'm out of Prosecco. So we have two problems. We'll have you back on to learn more about mitochondria sometime in the future. Thank you again for joining the show. I want to remind you to use the chat function and panelists and all attendees option to leave comments. We're looking for new members for our center. So if you have a desire to find a new career in the area of healthy longevity, there's a QR code at the end of the webinar. Also, we're starting to advertise some of our new papers coming out, and we have a new paper, The Potential Benefits of Assessing Post-Cardiopulmonary Exercise Testing in Aging. And so you can see the link to that in the chat box. Our next speaker is yet to be confirmed. That's one of the best speakers you can ever get. You'll be surprised next week by who it is, and so will we. The host will be Andrea Meyer. She'll be back. And with that, I want to leave you with a final video from our Minister of Health, Ong Yi Kong, who learned Taekwondo with Commonwealth champ Ng Ming Wei. And you can learn more about how to become a Taekwondo expert. Thanks for joining us.
Now my turn. Guys, I've tried my hands and legs at Silat, Muay Thai, Wushu. Today I'll try something that many kids are actually learning, which is Taekwondo with Ming Wei. Hi everyone. Martial arts like Taekwondo is really not about fighting, but about keeping fit, about discipline, as well as respect for each other.
I'm feeling like sunshine, like springtime, like something's in the water and I'm taking a deep dive. I'm feeling so weightless, like I'm gonna make it, and nothing universe can take this. I can see it clearly now. Nothing gonna bring me down.